Okay, next is we are having placenta, fetal metabolic saturation, placental barrier. Of course, the multiple pregnancies to discuss. So, placenta. Placenta is a discoid, that means display, oreo decidual organ. That means it is having a chorion membrane as well as the decidual chorion on a fetal side, decidual on other side organ, which is highly vascular and attaches the fetus to the mother's uterine or through umbilical cord. So it is attaching the fetus to the mother's uterine or through umbilical cord. It consists of two components, matricula and fetus. It is the only organ that develops from two different individuals who are genetically different, that is fetus and mother. So organs usually develop in a single organism, but here the placenta is developing both from fetus and mother, who are genetically different. So this placenta is the only organ that is developing from two different individuals who are genetically different. The placenta provides exchange of gases, nutrients, metabolic waste products between mother and embryo. So the placenta provides exchange of gases, oxygen, carbon dioxide, nutrients, with the carbohydrates, proteins and other things present in the mother's blood, and metabolic waste that are produced in the fetus. This will be exchanged between mother and embryo. Now development of the placenta. The placenta is fetometabolic organ. So it is organ between the fetus and the mother. It consists of fetal component developed from the chorion and maternal component developed from the residua basalis. So it is having two components, fetal component developed from chorion, maternal component developed from residua basalis. Formation of trabeculae and trabeculate spaces. So during this formation of this development of fetus, the placenta, we are having some structures that we develop, that is the trabecula and intermediate spaces. The cells of cytotrophoblast proliferate and move on its surface. So as we saw, the blastocyst entering into the uterus and then submerging into the endometrium of the uterus, we are seeing it is having an outer cytotrophoblast cover. This cytotrophoblast cover produces mitosis, producing large number of cells which will be increasing in number, such that only protoplasm and nucleus will be remaining in cytoplasm are formed. So that layer is called syncytial trophoblast. The cells lose their cell membrane to form a continuous sheet of cytoplasm containing many nuclei. This layer is called syncytial trophoblast. The syncytial trophoblast grows rapidly, erodes decidua basalis and becomes thick. So this syncytial trophoblast erodes the endometrium of the uterus and it becomes thick. The small cavities appear in the thickened syncytial trophoblast, which continue to erode the decidua basalis. So in this syncytial trophoblast, as it continues to erode the decidua basalis, there will be gaps between the cells, between the protoplasm and the nuclei, which we are calling as lacunae. As the development goes up, this lacunae will be growing more and more, and the boilers, they are separated from each other, and this lacunae become increased and they are separated from each other by portions of syncytial trophoblast called trabeculae. So as the syncytial trophoblast increases in size, the lacunae, the gap between the cells of the syncytial trophoblast develops, and this lacunae will be becoming bigger, and they will be separated from each other by strands of syncytial trophoblast, which we are calling as trabeculae or primary villus, villus primordia. As syncytial trophoblast further grows, it erodes the blood vessels of endometrium, and blood enters the lacunae along with secretions of endometrial tracts. So, as the syncytial trophoblast grows further, it erodes the blood vessels that are present in the endometrium, and the blood enters the lacunae. Lacunae is the space between the syncytial trophoblast along with the secretions of the endometrium. So the blood is entering the lacunae along with the secretions of the endometrial glands. Later, the lacunae communicate with each other around the tubercle and form intramural spaces. So, around the strands of syncytial fibula, the lacunae communicate with each other and that forms the intramural space, the space between the tubule. Thus, each tubercle gets surrounded all around by blood filled spaces in the endometrium. So, in the endometrium, the tubercle are coming from the syncytial fibroblast and they are surrounded by the intramural space which is filled with the mother's blood. So, development of villi. The chorionic villi develop as finger like sprouts from the chorea to maximize the surface area that comes in contact with the maternal blood for exchange of gases and nutrition. So, the chorea will develop finger like sprouts which will maximize the surface area that comes in contact with the maternal blood for exchange of gases and nutrients. Hello. Are you on the right side? Security type kitchen spoon. And kitchen spoon, I am class level. No. The chorionic villi develop as finger-like sprouts from chorea to maximize the surface area that comes in contact with the maternal blood for exchange of gases and nutrients. Types of villi. The chorionic villi are three types which develop in succession. Primary villi. The cytotrophoblast forms finger-like projections that invade tubercle in its center. The finger-like projections of cytotrophoblasts surrounded by a layer of syncytial trophoblast are called primary villi. So now the syncytial trophoblast, which is developing outside the cytotrophoblast of the blastocyst. Blastocyst is the embryo, and they are protruding into the decidua, basalis, or the endometrium of the uterus, and this will be become tubercle because of the spaces that has developed. I mean, lacunae that are developed around this, the projections of the syncytium, the projections we are calling as tubercle. So now into this tubercle, the cytotrophoblast will project lining the inner surface of this syncytium, the finger-like projection of the syncytium. So now this part is having a inner layer of cytotrophoblast, outer layer of syncytial fibroblast, which is called as primary villi. Now secondary villi. The extraembryonic subtubule mesoderm lying deep to the cytotrophoblast now invade the center of the each villus. So when we are talking in third week of development, we have seen the development of the extraembryonic serum, and before that the mesoderm that develops developing outside the primary observed amnion and inside the trophoblast. So this mesoderm is there. Now it is invading the inner layer, inner surface of the cytotrophoblast. Now this villi is having outer syncytial trophoblast, middle cytotrophoblast, and inner mesoderm. This is called secondary villi. As a result, now each villi is consisting of three layers from inside to outside. These are mesoderm, inside innermost cytotrophoblast, middle, and outermost syncytial trophoblast. Tertiary villi is repeat. The blood vessels develop into mesoderm of the secondary villi. Now it is called tertiary villi. So now the blood vessels are developing from planetoids and they will protrude into this finger-like projections of the secondary villi. So now after the entry of the blood vessels, it is called tertiary villi. So here we are showing the figure. The primary villi is having only the syncytial trophoblast and cytotrophoblast, that is outer syncytial trophoblast and cytotrophoblast. Then the secondary villi is having the syncytial trophoblast, the cytotrophoblast, and this green one is the mesoderm. Whereas the tertiary villi is having all the things: the syncytial trophoblast, the cytotrophoblast, the mesoderm, and the vessels, the artery and vein, the fetal artery and vein. Now, cytotrophoblastic shell and neighboring villi. The cells of cytotrophoblast in the apical region of each villi proliferate, pierce and pass across the cytotrophoblast to form a continuous layer of cytotrophoblast at the surface of the cilia. The cells of cytotrophoblast in the apical region of each villi proliferate, pierce and pass across the cytotrophoblast to form a continuous layer of cytotrophoblast at the surface of the cilia. So the finger-like projections are there. At this finger-like position, there is cytotrophoblast and immediately cytotrophoblast. Of course, inside we are having cytotrophoblast. This cytotrophoblast proliferates sidewards such that it reaches the cytotrophoblast of the next villi, next tobacco, and next like that. It will be forming a continuous layer between the cytotrophoblast and the decidua. So this cytotrophoblast layer, the cytotrophoblastic shell. So the cytotrophoblastic layer that is connecting the tips of the tubercle that are protruding into the decidua, when they are connected to each other, they become a continuous shell. So we are calling that as cytotrophoblastic shell. The cytotrophoblast is completely isolated from the decidua basalis. The cytotrophoblastic shell fixes all the villi to the decidua. Here, the villi will be fixed to the decidua by the cytotrophoblastic shell. These villi are now attached at one end to the chorea and to the decidua basalis at the other end. Because the villi are fixed at both ends, now they are called anchoring villi. So here we are showing the figure. This part is the decidua basalis and this is the chorea, chorean layer of the embryo. And from here we are seeing this is cytotrophoblast and cytotrophoblast mesodermal vessels. They are forming the tubercle which are reaching the deepest part. And from the tips of the tubercle, the cytotrophoblast is proliferating sidewards such that all the tips of tubercle are connected to each other, and finally a layer of this cytotrophoblast is formed between the decidua basalis here and the chorea here, that is the villi here. So this cytotrophoblastic shell which is having the villi here is anchoring this villi to the decidua. So now this villi, as they are connected, they are fixed to the decidua on the inner side and to the chorea on the outer side. These are called the fixing villi. Anchoring villi. Okay, fixing villi, anchoring villi. So these anchoring villi are branching to form more number of villi, which we are calling as free villi. These are the free villi. This is the anchoring villi 3 here, and here we are having the branches of the anchoring villi, the free villi. Whereas the tips of this anchoring villi are connected to each other by a cytotrophoblastic cell, a layer of cytotrophoblastic cells, which we are calling as cytotrophoblastic shell. And this cytotrophoblastic shell is separating this syncytium from this decidua basalis of the mother, and at the same time this is fixing the tips of this anchoring villi to the decidua. The anchoring villi gives up numerous offshoots that grow and move freely into the interval space as free villi. This increases the surface area for absorption. So this branching is to increase the surface area for absorption. Now lobulation of placenta. After the formation of anchoring villi, a number of septa grow inward from the uterine endometrium into the intravillous space and divide the placenta into irregular convex areas called cotyledons. So once we are having the anchoring villi, the cytotrophoblastic shell, then the decidua. Now from the decidua, a number of septa are going inward from the uterine membrane into the intervillous space. Intervillous space is, that is between the tubercle that is of course filled with the maternal gland and on the secretion. So there is septa that are reaching the chorea. They are forming, they are dividing the placenta into irregular convex areas called cotyledons. Each cotyledon is having 2 to 3 anchoring villi. So suppose say around these 2 to 3 anchoring villi, there is a septa developed from the nasitua basalis to reach the chorea. This septa is dividing this placenta into number of cotyledons, and each cotyledon will be having 2 to 3 anchoring villi. As the pregnancy progresses, the placenta enlarges to meet the need of the fetus. At the term, the placenta covers nearly 30% of internal surface of uterus. So, at the term, it is covering 30% of internal surface of uterus. The placenta, full term placenta, it is like flat, circular, disc-shaped, compact mass of vascular tissue. The placenta is nothing but a compact mass of vascular tissue, as the arteries and veins from the endometrium are coming from the mother side, and the arteries and veins from the fetal side are coming, and there the in the trabeculae or in the lacunae, the space in between the trabeculae, we are seeing the mother's blood, and the blood in the trabeculae, the blood of the fetus in the trabeculae are coming in contact with each other, where exchange of gases, I mean the nutrients and the metabolic waste are taking place. So now, this placenta is a highly vascular structure. Now, features of full term placenta. It is like a flat circular disc with a diameter of 15 to 20 centimeters, weighs about 500 grams. It presents two surfaces, maternal and fetal surface. So, this placenta, if you see, it is like a circular disc, about 15 to 20 centimeters in diameter and weighing about 500 grams. It presents two surfaces, a maternal surface and fetal surface. The maternal surface presents 15 to 20 lobes or cotyledons. So maternal surface is irregular, having 15 to 20 lobes or cotyledons. See, this is the maternal surface having the 15 to 20 cotyledons, and the surface is irregular. Whereas the fetal surface, this is the fetal surface, is covered with the chorea and the amnia and vessels from the umbilical cord are spreading over the fetal surface. So the fetal surface presents a smooth shining surface at the center of which umbilical cord is attached. So this is the smooth shining surface, the center of which umbilical cord is attached. And of course you are seeing number of vessels that are coming out of the umbilicus and going into the placenta. Now placental barrier. The placental membrane separates the maternal and fetal blood within the placenta. Thus there is no mixing of maternal and fetal blood in the placenta. The intravillous spaces are filled with maternal blood derived from the endometrial arteries and drained by the endometrial spaces. I told you in the development there is the trabeculae that is going in, and trabeculae gradually will develop into villus, anchoring villus. This will be giving place to free villi, and the space between the two villi, we are having the intervillous space which is filled with, we usually call it as lacunae. This lacunae is filled with mother's blood that is derived from the endometrial arteries, and this blood will be drained by the endometrial veins. The chorionic villi, this villi, free villi and anchoring villi, will be containing fetal blood vessels. The maternal blood in the intravillous space is separated from the fetal blood in the fetal blood vessels by the placental membrane called placenta barrier. So this blood in the villi are separated from the maternal blood in the lacunae by the fetal barrier, placental barrier, which is forming the wall of the villi itself. So what are those things? It is across this membrane the exchange of gases, nutrients and metabolic waste products takes place between the maternal and fetal blood, constituents of this placental membrane. So this placental membrane is nothing but the covering of the villi. So what is having the outermost secretion of the blast, that is in touch with the maternal blood. Then inner to it we are having cytotrophoblast, then basement of cytotrophoblast, then mesoderm pore, then we are having capillaries. So the capillaries will be having endothelium and basement membrane. So the innermost is the capillaries, which wall is having endothelium and basement membrane. So now we have to say the five layers as the outermost is the syncytial trophoblast, which is in contact with the mother's blood in the lacunae, and inside it is we are having cytotrophoblast, and the basement membrane are the cytotrophoblast cells. Then inside it we are having mesoderm. Then inside it we are having capillaries, which are having endothelium and basement membrane. So these are the five layers that are separating the mother's blood from the fetal blood present in the villi. Now in the latter part of the pregnancy, as the fetus and its nutrition demands increase, the placental membrane becomes thin to increase the efficiency of transport of nutrients across it. So as the pregnancy progresses, the fetus grows and its nutrition demands also increases. As it increases, the placental membrane becomes thin in order to increase the efficiency of transport of nutrients across it. So as it becomes thin, the nutrients will be flowing faster. So thus in the early part of the pregnancy, the placental membrane is about 0.025 millimeter thickness. But in the later part, that is in the developed fetus, the bigger fetus, this membrane, that is the placental barrier, will be about 0.002 millimeter thickness. That is, it has decreased 10 times, its thickness by 10 times. Factors responsible for thinning of placenta. How this is occurring? The syncytial trophoblast becomes thin. Syncytial trophoblast, which is thicker at the beginning, will become thin. The cytotrophoblast will disappear. So, cytotrophoblast, the cells and the basement membrane will be disappearing. And then, the basement membrane and cytotrophoblast capillaries also disappears. So, the basement membrane of fetal capillaries also disappear. So now we are having endothelial surface of fetal capillary cells become thin. So we are having only endothelial cells and a thin syncytial trophoblast. So now this become the barrier. See, here we are seeing, this is in the beginning. We are seeing the early fetus. We are seeing the syncytial trophoblast, cytotrophoblast, basement membrane. Then the capillaries. Capillaries will be having the basement membrane, the cells are. Whereas, as the pregnancy progresses, as the fetus develops into a larger size, what is happening? Here we are seeing the syncytial trophoblast has gone down, that is, it has become thin. The cytotrophoblastic cells and their basement membrane has completely disappeared. And the cells on the walls of the capillaries, they lost their basement membrane. So, only the cell wall of the capillaries on the villi, cell wall of the vessels of the fetus, the cell wall of the capillaries and the a small amount of syncytial trophoblast, they will be forming the placental barrier in the late pregnancy. So the placental barrier is thinned out from 0.0125 to 0.002 mm. So in the humans, metal blood is separated from fetal blood by chorionic tissue, hence human placenta is called hemochorion. Placental circulation. So now how the blood is circulating in this placenta? The circulation of the blood in the placenta is of two types, maternal and fetal. So maternal blood is coming into the placenta and going out of placenta, and fetal blood is going to the placenta and going out of the placenta. So one side there is a maternal circulation, another side there is a fetal circulation. The maternal placental circulation is about 80 to 100 spiral arteries and number of means of uterine endometrium open into the intermediate space. So the maternal arteries and the maternal veins are opening. This is the intermediate space where we are having the anchoring villi and the free villi. interval space and number of veins of uterine cavity open to the mouth. The blood enters the interval space through spiral arteries, and under the pressure of blood in the arteries, the blood reaches right up to the chorionic plate, then slowly passes around the branches of villi for exchange across very thin placental membrane. The blood from the interval space is drained by veins of vesicula basalis. So here, because of the pressure of the blood in the arteries, it is reaching the chorionic plate, and then it is distributed around this free villi gradually. And here the exchange of the gases, the nutrients, and the metabolic waste is occurring. Then once it has gone, then the blood is drained by the endometrial veins, maternal endometrial veins. So maternal endometrial arteries are pushing the blood into this interval spaces, where the blood is spreading around this free and angry villi, and then after the exchange of gases, nutrients and metabolites, again it is passed back to the mother through the maternal veins. Now, fetal placental circulation. The fetal blood comes to the placenta through the umbilical arteries. These arteries, after entering the placenta, ramify freely in the chorion, and their branches enter the chorionic villi. The veins from the chorionic villi drain into the umbilical vein that carries blood rich in oxygen and nutrients to the fetus from the placenta. Okay, now here we are. See, then now the fetal arteries or the umbilical arteries are getting blood into the villi, interval space villi, the free villi and angry villi. And here, after the exchange of the gases, nutrients, metabolites has taken place, it is collected by the umbilical vein, and then it is going back to the heart of the fetus. So here you have to see that the fetal heart is pumping blood out to the placenta and again drawing the blood from the placenta. So the vessels going out of the fetal heart we are calling as arteries. The arteries, though they are carrying carbon dioxide and metabolic waste, though the color is blue, they are represented blue, no? So they are two in number, and even though we are calling them arteries, they are carrying deoxygenated blood as well. A single vein is there which is going back from this placenta after collecting the blood from the trabeculae or intervertebral space, and it is going back along with a single vein. This is the umbilical vein, but this is represented red because it is carrying oxygenated blood from the placenta. So the color is not because of its artery or vein, but because of the blood, the type of blood that it is carrying. If it is carrying deoxygenated blood, even though it is artery, we are putting blue color. If it is carrying oxygenated blood, even though it is a vein, we are putting it a red color. So we have to note this one. Even in the lung, cardiopulmonary circulation also, this will be like that. The pulmonary arteries will be blue, whereas pulmonary vein will be red. The veins from the chorionic villi drain into the umbilical vein that carries blood rich in oxygen and nutrients to the fetus of the placenta. There is a single umbilical vein and two umbilical arteries. We have to note this also. Now, functions of the placenta. The fetus is attached to the mother by placenta. Exchange of gases. So, the main function is exchange of gases. This involves supply of oxygen from maternal blood to the fetal blood and removal of carbon dioxide from fetal blood to the maternal blood. The full-term fetus takes about 20 to 30 ml of oxygen per minute from maternal blood. So, maternal blood should be having a rich supply of oxygen such that it is giving about 20 to 30 ml of oxygen per minute to the fetal blood. Therefore, a short interruption in the oxygen supply to the fetus may be fatal. So, as I told you, okay, in the umbilical cord, when there is a prolapse of umbilical cord. There is a, the umbilical cord will be compressed by the coming head and pelvic wall. So there is a interruption of the oxygen supply to the fetus. So what is happening? The fetus will be anoxic and there will be severe disturbance in the brain of the fetus. So that may be proving fetal. Sometimes the fetus may die of anoxia. So it has to be supplied about 20 to 30 ml of oxygen per day. Now transport of nutrients. Apart from the exchange of the gases, transport of nutrients is also the function of placenta. Here the carbohydrates, fats, proteins, amino acids, vitamins, electrolytes are transported from the mother blood to the fetal blood in the placenta only. Now excretion of waste products like metabolic products of metabolism like urea, uric acid that is produced in the fetus are thrown into the mother blood in the placenta only. So first thing is exchange of gases. Second thing is transport of nutrients from mother to the fetus. Third thing is transport of metabolic waste from the fetus to the mother. Now, transmission of maternal antibodies. The maternal antibodies, alpha globulin and immunoglobulins, can cross the placenta barrier and cross from mother to fetus against infectious diseases such as diphtheria, measles, and poliomyelitis, but not against chickenpox and whooping cough. Okay. Certain diseases that are producing immunoglobulins in the mother, and these immunoglobulins can pass through the placental barrier into the fetus. Whereas in some other diseases, even though the immunoglobulins are produced in the mother, they are not able to pass through this placenta. So, example for this immunoglobulins that are not able to pass are immunoglobulins like the chickenpox and whooping cough. So, and the example for the immunoglobulins that can pass through the placenta are the diphtheria, measles, and polio. So, certain diseases can be protected from the immunoglobulins that are passing through the mother to the child through placenta. And for other certain diseases, there is no protection from the mother. Barrier function. This placental barrier acts as barrier to many bacteria and organisms. Some of these are their toxins manage to cross the barrier and they can reset them, such as rubella simplicitis. It also acts as barrier for maternal hormones such as ACTH and TSH. So, this placenta is acting as barrier to most of the bacteria and viruses. There are certain viruses and bacteria which are able to pass through this placental barrier. They can cause disease in the fetus. The example is rubella, etc. And on the other hand, this barrier is completely obstructing the transport of ACTH and TSH from mother to fetus. Now, production of hormones. This placenta's other function is production of hormones. The main one is the progesterone in sufficient amount to maintain the pregnancy. That is to maintain the blood supply in the endometrium, as we have it in the menstrual phases, the secretory phase. As the progesterone increases, there is increase of the blood flow, and immediately after this secretory phase, the menstrual phase, the blood vessels will be closed because of the less amount of progesterone coming from the ovum into the uterus. So the menstruation will start. So like that, if the decidua has to grow more, has to give good blood supply, the progesterone from the child will be increasing, I mean from the placenta will be stimulating the blood supply to the placenta. Then estrogens promote uterine growth and development of mammary glands. Okay, as the fetus is growing, uterine also has to grow. So estrogens that are produced by this placenta are promoting the uterine growth. At the same time, they are stimulating the mammary gland to prepare to be ready to give milk to the outcoming child. So this placental estrogen is also acting on the mammary gland to improve its size, its secretion, and other things like that. Now HCG, which is which has an effect similar to LH of the pituitary gland. So this HCG, human pulmonary gonadotropin, is also produced by the placenta, of course, which is used to diagnose the pregnancy. Now somatotrophins, which has anti-insulin effect. These somatotrophins on this placenta will be having anti-insulin effect on maternal blood, causing increased plasma levels of glucose and amino acids in the maternal blood to enhance their utilization by the fetus. So as the fetus needs more amount of the glucose and the amino acids, this somatotrophin that is released from the placenta is acting on the maternal blood to increase the levels of the sugar and amino acids, such that more amount of these sugars and amino acids are available for the fetus. Now storage function. It acts as storage house for glycogen, calcium and iron in the early months of pregnancy, and however this function will be taken by liver as soon as the liver develops. Now so these are the seven functions: the exchange of gases, the exchange of nutrients, the exchange of metabolites, the secretion of hormones, and then transmission of maternal antibodies, and barrier function against certain bacteria and virus. And then we are having the production of hormones like progesterone, estrogen, HCG, somatotrophins, and then finally the storage function. Oh, this storage function will be gradually taken over by the liver. Now, congenital anatomies of the placenta. So, what are the types of abnormalities that can develop? They are grouped into three types. Anatomies due to the abnormal adherence of chorionic villi to the uterus. So, in the adherence of the chorionic villi to the uterus, there is anatomies. Anatomies due to the abnormal shape of the placenta. Anatomies due to the abnormal site of attachment of umbilical cord. Usually, the umbilical cord is attached to the center of the fetal surface of the placenta. And of course, if this attachment varies, we are calling anatomies. We are the part of those things. Now, anatomies due to abnormal adherence of chorionic villi. So, this chorionic villi is usually adhering to the decidua of the uterus, that is the endometrium of the uterus. And now, if this chorionic villi is attached to the myometrium, so after passing through the decidua, it is attached to the myometrium. We are calling it as placenta accreta. And placenta accreta is when they penetrate full thickness of myometrium, and placenta precreta is when they penetrate full thickness of myometrium and perimetrium. So, as long as they are in the endometrium only, it is normal. And if they reach, after passing through the endometrium, they reach the myometrium and touch the myometrium, we are calling as placenta accreta. And if they completely pierce the myometrium, we are calling as placenta increta. Placenta increta. If this villi pierces the myometrium and also reaches the perimetrium and pierces it, then we are calling as placenta precreta. So we are showing here in the figure. If it is up to this only, it is placenta barba. And once it has pierced this complete endometrium completely and reached the myometrium, we are calling it as placenta increta. That means it has reached the placenta accreta, it has reached the myometrium. Whereas it has completely pierced the myometrium, we are calling it as placenta increta. Here it is touching the myometrium, only by beginning. Whereas here it is piercing the myometrium. It is increta. And it has pierced the myometrium and pierced the perimetrium, we are calling it as placenta percreta. Placenta accreta is completely piercing the endometrium, reaching the myometrium. Placenta increta is piercing the myometrium completely. Whereas placenta percreta is piercing the myometrium as well as perimetrium and going on. This is placenta percreta. So these are various types of attachment of the villi. Because of the various types of attachment of the villi, the placenta is cascading into placenta accreta, placenta increta, and placenta percreta. Now, because of the abnormal shapes of the placenta, we are seeing, normally I told you, the placenta is a circular or discoid. Now, if it is bilobed placenta, it is one of the abnormal. So, the placenta will be having two lobes. multilobular placenta. Placenta will be having more than 2 kg. Diffuse placenta. Placenta is thin and not disc shaped. It occurs when chorionic villi persist all around the blastocyst. So chorionic villi at embryonic pole will be usually disappearing. If they persist at embryonic node on the sides, it will be a diffuse placenta, and that is also that is an abnormality. Placenta succinturata. It is a small part of the placenta separated from the main part, but remains connected through the blood vessels and placental membrane. So placenta is a discarded one. If a small part of it is separated and it is having continuity with the blood vessels in the main placenta, we are calling it as placenta succinturata. So here, bilobed placenta, multilobed placenta, diffuse placenta, and here placenta succinturata, that means a small part is going out and it is connected with the blood vessels. Then placenta fenestrata. Here there is a gap in the placenta, in the discoid placenta. We are calling it as placenta fenestrata. And circumvallate placenta, when the placenta is surrounding the decidua. The peripheral edge of placenta is covered by the circular fold of decidua. So the placenta is surrounded by decidua. We are calling it as circumvallate placenta. Now, anabolism due to abnormal sites of attachment of umbilical cord. So we have seen anabolism due to the, insertion into the endometrium, myometrium, and perimetrium, and anabolism due to the shape of the placenta. Now, anabolism due to the site of attachment of umbilical cord. Normally, umbilical cord is attached to the center of the placenta and the fetal surface, and the anabolism are marginal placenta, when the cord is attached to the margin of the placenta. Furcate placenta, when the blood vessels of the umbilical cord divide before reaching the placenta. Velamentous placenta, when umbilical blood vessels are attached to the amnion and ramify there before reaching the placenta. So here we are seeing, this is the marginal placenta or patulate placenta, and this is the furcate placenta, where the placenta vessels are dividing before reaching the amnion, and this is the velamentous placenta, where umbilical vessels are ramifying in the amnion itself before reaching the placenta proper. So these are the various types of abnormalities in the attachment of the umbilical cord to the placenta. Marginal placenta, then furcate placenta, then velamentous placenta. Now, multiple pregnancy. So, we have completed the placenta, how the placenta is formed, and the functions of the placenta, and the fetal circulation and metal circulation of the placenta, and then finally, the abnormality of the placenta due to the insertion of the villi into the uterus, and due to the shapes of the placenta, and due to the insertion of the umbilical cord into the placenta. These are the various types of abnormalities of the placenta. Now we go for the multiple pregnancy. The pregnancy carrying more than one fetal system has multiple pregnancy. It is classified into twins, two babies, triplets, three babies, quadruplets, four babies, quintuplets, five babies, depending upon the number of fetuses. Because the incidence of twins is most common, we are discussing twins only. Twins, that means nourishing two conceptors, two embryos, two fetuses at the same time is called twinning. There are two types of twins, monozygotic and dizygotic. Arrangement of fetal membranes in twins varies considerably depending upon the type of the twins. Dizygotic twins, about 2/3 of twins are dizygotic twins. Dizygotic twins, that means two different zygotes are formed. And their incidence increases with maternal age. As the maternal age increases, this dizygotic twins will be more. This results from fertilization of two different oocytes by two different sperms. The resultant two zygotes form two blastocysts, each of which implant separately in the uterine endometrium. These twins are not genetically alike, they do not look alike, and they can be of different sex also. Now, in such twins, the placenta, ovary, and amniotic sac are different. That means there are two placenta to pollen and to embryonic sac. The two placenta may fuse with each other. Sometimes the two placenta may fuse. The human dizygotic twins are more frequent than monozygotic twins. In human, dizygotic twins are more frequent than monozygotic. And in the dizygotic twins, usually two boys are more common. Next common is a boy and a girl, and the least common is two girls. In the human dizygotic twins, two girls are least common, and most common is two boys. Monozygotic twins. Results from fertilization of one oocyte by one sperm, and resultant zygote forms a blastocyst in which inner cell wall splits into two. So, up to the formation of zygote, it is not much. That is, a single oocyte is fertilized by a single sperm, and zygote is formed. Here, the zygote is forming a inner embryo blast, not a total blast. This inner embryo blast initially is a single mass, but it splits into two. It is forming monozygotic twin. Therefore, the monozygotic twins are genetically identical. They are having all the characters of the chromosome same. And these twins are of the same sex and look alike. So, they will be having same sex and they look alike. They have common chorionic and embryonic sacs. The placenta is one, but umbilical cords are two. Sometimes two independent placenta are formed, which may fuse with each other but does not have elastomers of blood vessels. So sometimes these two placenta may fuse with each other but their blood vessels remain separate. The zygote normally there are still more blastoids, but when it is converted into a blastocyst, the two inner cell masses form within it. Each of its development may fuse. So it is the formation of monozygotic twins, wherein the blastocyst will be forming two masses and then they will be developing into two different fetuses. In this condition, the two fetuses have a common placenta. Placenta is common, but each lie in independent amniotic cell. The amniotic cell will be different. Congenital anomalies of twins. So, what are the abnormalities that can occur in this monozygotic twin? Conjoined twins. In this condition, is seen in monozygotic twins, the embryo blast does not completely split and hence two feces are joined together by a tissue bridge. See, as we told you, we are seeing the formation of two embryo blasts and they have to separate and then they have to develop their amnion, their ovarian and then the umbilical cord and of course placenta will be seen. But sometimes what is happening is this separation of embryo blasts is incomplete. And there is a band of tissue that is bridging these two embryo blasts. Then, depending upon the site of this band, this conjoined twins, as because of the band, the twins will be attached to each other. So, these conjoined twins are divided into four types depending upon the extension of this fusion. So, craniophagus, that is fusion of two heads. Thoracophagus, fusion of thorax. Cephalothoracophagus, fusion of head and thorax. Pygophagus, that is fusion of sacral region. So, if the both heads are fused together, we are called as craniophagus. And the head and thorax is fused together, we are called as thoracophagus. And if the, the head and thorax are fused together, we are calling cephalothoracophagus. If the thorax only, it is thoracophagus. If the head only, it is craniophagus. Craniophagus, thoracophagus, cephalothoracophagus, and pygophagus. Pygophagus, if the fetuses are fused with sacral region. The conjoined twins can be separated only if they have no vital parts in common. So, if only the epidermis or some parts of the bone are fused together, they can be separated. If they have a common circulatory system, they have a common respiratory system or a common respiratory system, the separation will be very difficult or they may not be separated. Parasitic twin. When one member of conjoined twin remains rudimentary due to poor blood supply and grows like a parasite from the body of well-developed poor twin. It is termed as a parasitic twin. So the twins, there are two embryos, but if one embryo is rudimentary and it has a poor blood supply and it grows from the blood from the well-developed the twin, his twin brother, then it is called a parasitic twin. Occasionally, this parasitic twin may be completely enclosed in the body of the embryo. That is, sometimes this may be, this parasitic twin may be seen in the abdominal cavity of the co-brother. So it is called fetus in fetus. Twins have high incidence of morbidity and mortality due to pre-eclampsia, congenital anomalies, premature delivery, etc. The risk of chromosomal anomalies and fetal mortality is higher in multiple pregnancies. The number of fetus is directly proportional to increase in risk. As the number of fetus increases, that is 2, 3, 4, 5. So there will be more, the risk will be more as the number of fetus increases. So that finishes the multiple pregnancy. Now, pregnancy test. So pregnancy test is based on the detection of human chorionic gonadotropin. Human chorionic gonadotropin, which is produced by the placenta, is produced by the placenta shortly after fertilization and reaches detectable levels in urine and serum about 1 week after implantation. Attachment of the embryo, early embryo to the uterine lining. That is, implantation is the attachment of the early embryo to the uterine lining. So that is, 1 week after implantation, this human gonadotropin, human chorionic gonadotropin is seen in urine and serum. Levels of HCG continues to rise during the first trimester of pregnancy, making it an excellent marker of pregnancy. So, in the first trimester of pregnancy, the levels of human chorionic gonadotropin will be rising, such that it will be the marker of pregnancy. It will be the detection of this hormone in the blood, can say that the person is pregnant. Pregnancy test can be done either by urine or blood samples. Both tests detect the presence of the hormone, that is human chorionic gonadotropin. So a quantitative blood test measures the exact amount of beta human chorionic gonadotropin in the blood by electrochemiluminescence ECL based immunoassay and a qualitative HCG test gives simple positive and negative results to whether pregnant or not, strips and cassettes. So, a quantitative test can be done by electrochemiluminescence test based on immunoassay, that is needs a elaborate equipment other things. Whereas a qualitative HCG test gives simple positive or negative results by strips is dipped in the blood or urine. They can easily say whether the HCG is present and whether the person is pregnant or not. And urine test. Urine specimens must be collected without preservatives in a clean, dry container. First morning urine usually contains highest concentration of HCG. However, urine collected at any time during the day may be used to test. If the sample put collection container into the refrigerator, the sample will be rejected. So, we should not put this sample in the fridge. That cannot detect the HCG. So, frozen urine leads to less accurate results because of stone forming salts becomes crystallized and thus results are less viable. So, that's all the thing. So, urine test should be done on fresh urine. Need not be the early morning urine. Urine of any times will be having this human chorionic gonadotropin. So, fresh urine taken from the person will be tested for this human chorionic gonadotropin and that will give an exact result. But by chance, if you put it in the refrigerator and take it out and then test it, it may give wrong results. I mean, false positive or false negative effect. So, the pregnancy test is mainly by noting the presence of the human chorionic gonadotropin, which can be seen in the urine and blood of the mother, and which can be tested easily, and fresh urine and fresh blood only. It should not be refrigerated before testing. And of course, the various types of feeds, the monozygotic, the dizygotic, the haploidies of the monozygotic twins. Then of course, the types of placenta, various types of placenta, the functions of the placenta. All these things just to please read once or twice and then compare these figures. And mainly this placental barrier. This is very important. This is the question where you will be seeing barriers for most present in the exam. So please compare this figure. Try to memorize this figure. You can easily score good marks. And of course, this is the practical question where you will be seeing a model with maternal surface on one side, fetal surface on another model. So we have to identify the maternal surface by the presence of number of cotyledons, whereas fetal surface by the presence of the chorion and the attachment of umbilical cord. The fetal surface is known for its attachment of umbilical cord in the center of the placenta and the various vessels of the umbilical cord. Then of course, fetal placental fluctuation. This one, this figure you have to remember. Of course, the villi. This villi is also important. The primary villi, secondary villi, tertiary villi. Primary villi having syncytium, cytotrophic robots. Secondary villi having thumbar added layer of mesoderm. Tertiary villi having added layer, added blood vessels. So this also, this figure also you have to remember. So that finishes the general embryology. Next class I will be starting embryology of the respiratory system as well as cardiovascular system. So please read well for this exam, this general embryology, and you will face many questions for this part. Thank you.